Very good morning to everyone. We are back. Euros are back. The most awaited tournament, I'd say, for the last couple of years. I have with me Siddharth. Hi, Siddharth. How are you?
Thanks, Yash. I'm doing good. Just like everyone, I can't wait for the Euros to start, man.
It's just pretty exciting because we've been waiting for over a year now. And finally, Euro 2020 is happening in Euro 2021. So what do you have to say about the delay and the excitement that has been, you know, created throughout?
The delay, yes, coronavirus did play a huge impact over here and everyone is awaiting it. Okay. Over a year of pressure has been built up on all the teams. There's going to be a lot of fatigue, in fact, during these matches, because the last Premier League or any of the local leagues in Europe were compressed because of COVID. So there's going to be a lot of fatigue in the teams, and the squad management is going to be a huge factor over here during the Euros.
Absolutely. Absolutely, that's true. And the first time ever in the history of Euros, there have been 11 host countries, and that's something that I've never seen. You know, 11 different countries, there is no home ground, no home fortress for any team, no away team domination. What do you have to say about this?
Absolutely. It's going to be a challenge for a lot of teams. In fact, when Michael Platini had announced it in 2012 that, you know, this tournament is going to be hosted by several nations as a romantic one-off. Okay. It's basically to celebrate the 60th birthday of the European Championships. Everyone was taken aback, you know, like how are they going to manage it? Because wherever it is, okay, it's never a home country. Okay.
Yeah.
You have one or two hosts co-hosting the tournament, and is an added advantage to them, but this time there's no such advantage.
There isn't.
In fact, while qualifying, there was another change. There was no automatic qualification. So the 11 countries that did guest host nations didn't qualify automatically. All 55 of the UEFA nations had to go through the qualifying process.
Yeah. And it's pretty difficult, Sid, as I said, and I watched the qualification games as well. Because amidst all the Premier League and Champions League action going on, the matches, the international matches, they just come once in, you know, 4 weeks, 5 weeks, and you have to capitalize on those two games that you play, and that makes a lot of difference. And now here we are, the last time, you know, Portugal winning it. What do you have to say? What do you think of the Portuguese team this time around? Because if you look at that squad, there is, you know, a very in-form Bruno Fernandes, an in-form Diego Jota. You know, Ruben Dias, the player of the season in the Premier League, and João Cancelo. What do you have to say about this team? Do you think it's better than the team that won the previous Euros?
Absolutely. So, while they are defending champions, okay, if the coach has the confidence to say that, you know, a person or a player like Cristiano Ronaldo, who everyone considers to be one of the greatest players ever, can be benched, okay? Just imagine that you can bench one of the best players in the world. That just says volumes about, you know, your squad depth. Okay, when you say, also look at their squad, the core has remained the same in the midfield, Joao Martino, William Carvalho, etc. Even the defense, okay, has been consistent. Though they're breeding a lot of youngsters through, you have Silva coming through, you have Ruben Dias who will be coming through right now, okay, fresh off the Premier League player of the tournament, as you had just mentioned. Okay, so there's a lot of pressure on them as well. So it's up to Cristiano Ronaldo, you know, Pepe, Jose Font, who's just won the Ligue 1 as well.
Yes, he has.
Okay,
good one.
To give them the confidence to nurture these youngsters.
That's really important, you know. And being a Cristiano Ronaldo is absolutely, it's a privilege, but it's very, what do you say, a lot of pressure on you as well. Because
Absolutely.
There are people who are waiting to put you down, as Cristiano Ronaldo always says that it's all white noise to him, what people write about him and speak about him. So speaking of youngsters like João Felix and Ruben Dias, like you mentioned, do you think that they can handle pressure at the international level? Because playing in the Premier League, they're playing with the best of best players, and they are having that team chemistry and the sync because they, you know, play 24/7.
Absolutely.
But when you come at an international level, you just have had a 15-day camp or 20-day camp, and you're playing directly at the international level, and the
Absolutely.
Is backing you. So how difficult it is to play international football, and how different is it to play Premier League or Ligue 1? What are your thoughts on that?
So international football always poses its own challenges. Okay, you have to come in and play with people probably that you haven't played with. There are certain chemistries that you build with your teammates. Okay, playing day in, day out with them. But in a 15-day camp, there's only so much you can do. Okay.
Yes.
That's when the coach comes in. What are the tactics he drills in? How is he able to impose his style? Okay. Because if you check a Real Madrid or a Juventus vis-a-vis a United, okay, you have players from all of these top clubs. Each one has their own playing style, and that has been ingrained in them over the years.
Okay.
But also the fact that they have youngsters who have played with themselves in the youth leagues, in the youth tournaments, will play an advantage over them. And obviously the seniors giving them the confidence, nurturing them, taking them under their wing, that will also help.
And I've read a lot of, you know, articles, and everywhere it's being said that Portugal are the favorites to defend this title, given the fact that they won it with that squad. And one man, Cristiano Ronaldo, stepped up almost every match. And this time they have a great balance. So it's going to be an interesting, you know, competition this time around for Portugal. A group of death for them, but definitely
absolutely
an interesting one to watch out for. Don't you think so?
Absolutely. So there's going to be a lot of challenges, a lot of roadblocks. But I believe this team has it in to defend the championship.
Definitely, definitely. Everyone's backing Portugal. And now, speaking of Euros, you know, the most time any team has won the Euros is 3, and it's been shared by Germany and Spain. Because, you know,
absolutely,
you know that German era, Sid, we all have seen,
yeah,
you know, the Müller's era, and, you know, the big players that came from Germany, and they were the best team in those
absolutely
years. And speaking of Spain here, what are your thoughts on the Spain, you know, 2008 to 2012, those four golden years for them where they won everything, they lost nothing?
Yeah. Absolutely. So actually their record during that 6-year phase was impeccable. Okay. So over those 6 years, they played around 77, 78 games, I believe, and they won 65 of them and lost only 6.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
So the win percentage was absolutely phenomenal. But that being said, it was attributed to a strong core. Okay. The engine in midfield was run by Xavi and Iniesta, and all of us know. Okay. They were two of the best in the league. Okay,
that's true.
They're legends. Everyone tries to, you know, mold their game around Xavi and Iniesta, and that was their core, and that was the engine ticking. But also they had gatekeepers, okay, in the form of Iker Casillas, be it Ramos,
yeah,
Puyol, Pique. They were just absolute walls, so they wouldn't let anything in, okay. And that also gave freedom to the attackers. Now that is one thing where, you know, Spain had a dearth of attackers during that time. They also
yeah
had the audacity, you know. In the Euro 12, they won it with Cesc Fabregas. Okay, he's a midfielder, attacking midfielder, but he played as a false nine, and they won with him.
Yeah, yeah, and they beat Italy comprehensively. A 4-0 win,
yes,
in that final really proved the point that, you know, they are the best team in the world, and they really, those 4 years, the football that they played was really pleasing to the eye as well, because their style was similar to something what Barcelona played. And Xavi and Iniesta,
absolutely,
as they were, you know, teammates at Barcelona, and even David Villa, for a matter of fact, they got that game here. Carlos Puyol, Pique, all of
yeah
them have been, you know, Barcelona players. So the same game was imbibed, and the way they played, they dominated
absolutely
those 4 years.
Yeah. So the core, basically at that time, was Barcelona and Real Madrid. Interestingly, this time no Madrid players in the Spain squad.
Yeah.
So we'll see how that works.
And, you know, this is moving on now, you know, you have to talk about France, the World Cup winner, and you have to talk about the golden boy, the man who's always there in front of you, and Kylian Mbappe. What are your thoughts
absolutely
about him? What do you have to say about
yeah
that man, Mbappe, has been, and how has he played for France?
I mean, to speak for a 22-year-old, so experienced in the game, he burst onto the scene with Monaco, and, you know, stole
yeah
the championship from PSG, and at that time, Monaco was just trying to rebuild after their failed, you know, spend like probably Manchester City or PSG. They had sold a lot of their players. So, you know, Mbappe stepped up and got them the title at that time. And
yeah
then again, a 180 million transfer to PSG. Again, huge pressure on his shoulders, but he's been able to keep that up. And at 22, winning multiple Ligue 1 titles, you know, a Champions League final last year, a World Cup winner. You know, it's amazing at 22. And, you know, he plays different roles in different teams, be it PSG, Monaco, where he was a forefront. But in France, he's going to be, you know, mainly playing from the left, supporting Benzema or Giroud, or also playing as a second striker at times.
Yeah.
Right. So the tactics over there are going to be multiple for France. And Kylian has age on his side and versatility to play all those roles. I mean, even when you see France play, okay, he interchanges with Griezmann a lot. Okay, yes, sometimes he switches wings with Dembele.
Yep.
So he gives, you know, France and Deschamps that flexibility to maneuver different tactics, play with different teams, different, you know, strategies, and obviously get the results.
Absolutely. And Mbappe, when you look at him, he enjoys his football. You know, the amount of football that I have seen him play, he's always enjoyed his game. He's never, you know, frustrated because he knows he needs that snap opportunity and he's going to capitalize like he did, you know, against Bayern in the quarterfinals of the Champions League. So you know the kind of, you know, the impact that he gets on any team that he plays for. So he's going to be definitely a great player in this tournament, and a lot of expectations from him, from the French fans and all the, you know, footballing, you know, fans in the world. Speaking of, you know, your opinion, I would like to know, who do you think, you know, is the dark horse in this tournament? Because there are a lot of underdogs in this team, in this tournament, sorry. Speak of
Karoski, absolutely,
probably.
But I think,
you know,
the
what are your thoughts?
The biggest dark horse, and, you know, it's going to be a big talking point in this tournament, is going to be VAR, the visual assistant referee. It's the first time they're going to incorporate it in a major tournament of the Euros. And, you know, it was called for, but as we've seen in various league games or Champions League, it is controversial. It's more, it's proving more controversial than beneficial. So, obviously, the one dark horse is going to be VAR and how it performs in this Euros. But other than that, yes, Turkey has always been one of the dark horses.
Yeah.
But they have, because even if you see their qualifying campaign, brilliant qualifying campaign, which I'll talk more about later when you, you know, deep dive. But obviously, from a winner's perspective, yes, Portugal favorites to as reigning champions and with a brilliant squad.
Yeah.
And of course, France is the other team that will challenge them.
Absolutely. Yes. And, you know, like you said, Turkey is the dark horse. Who do you predict? Like, you know, it's just very, you know, unrealistic and maybe a vague call. But if you had to choose a winner, you know, at the very beginning, looking at the squads and the groups and how the tournament would pan out and the experience or the balance, who do you think would be?
Looking at everything put together, I can't see a better team than France. You know, Portugal comes a close second, but, you know, the way they've been playing over the last year or so, definitely France.
That's what most people think. So yeah, it has to be France because of the balance, and just like how we spoke about Mbappe and the team of Portugal, Ronaldo, all the legends in the team. So yeah, thank you for that. And quickly moving on, the first game of the Euros, it's Italy versus Turkey.
Absolutely. So big game on our hands. It's at the Stadio Olimpico in Rome. Okay, so Italians, a little bit of an advantage over there.
Yeah, that is.
Yeah.
So what are your thoughts on Italy and the football that they've played in the past 6 months or 8 months? You know, the records that they've had is impeccable. They're unbeaten in 27 odd games, including the friendlies and everything. So what do you have to say about this?
Italy does have a rich footballing history. I mean, they're four-time World Cup winners and they also have a Euros to show for it. Okay, and when you think of the Italian national team, it's always been a strong defense. Okay, ever since even in the Roberto Baggio era, okay, the divine ponytail. He was a lone man up front and everyone else was defending. And, you know, once the ball came to him, he would finish it. But, you know, Italy is... coming up and out of their shell, you know, after embarrassingly failing to qualify for the 2018 World Cup. There was a lot of pressure on them, okay? And they've risen to the occasion. Italy has actually won all 10 of their qualifying matches for Euro 2020.
Wow.
Okay, that's just equaling Belgium. Okay, they also had a perfect campaign. But, and as you said, they have a 27 match unbeaten run. So, they are on a rich form of way, you know. They are expected to win. Even their manager, Roberto Mancini, okay, has the highest win percentage as a manager of the Italian national team.
Exactly.
They've actually extended his contract to the 2026 World Cup.
Yeah.
That's the amount of confidence that they have in him right now. And he is building his team, you know, slowly and steadily. You know, at the centre-back stage, you have two of their stalwarts over there.
Definitely.
But as the tournaments progress, as the years progress, even that is one place where they will be evolving.
Yes, they will. Correct. You're actually right, Sid, out there. And, you know, speaking of the managers, like you rightly mentioned out, Roberto Mancini, he has won it all. You know, being the Premier League, and he's managed the Serie A side. He's done the international level, and he's been successful everywhere throughout, you know. But now, speaking of the Turkish manager, the competition that they would have, these two managers,
yeah.
What are your thoughts? Both have been excellent players in their countries as well. You know, Sibok Yunus, because he's played for Turkey as well, he has, you know, led them to a World Cup semi-final as well. So what are your thoughts, the character that he brings to his Turkish side?
Absolutely. You know, even Sibok, when he did play, he was captaining the side in the 2002 World Cup. And, you know, they lost out to eventual winners, Brazil, in the, you know, semi-finals 1-0. But it was a close match. No one expected Turkey to go that far, and he has led them. Okay, he knows the passion of going forward in a tournament. So that's going to be an extra motivation from inside, and he's going to motivate the players. Obviously, having your own countryman as your manager gives that extra push to you, both for Mancini and... No, Sibok. So that's they're going to push their teams. There's going to be a national over there. There's going to be a push. So I believe they will have that extra push from both their managers.
It's going to be personal for them, because, you know, you being an Italian, you're representing your country as a manager. It makes a lot of difference than, you know, probably another country manager managing your international team. I can understand what you're saying. And definitely the Turkish team have been underdogs every time. They've literally, you know, pushed big teams out of the tournament and have made sure that they are the, you know, dark horses all the time. And
absolutely,
this year they're going to have an interesting competition because they're playing Italy in the first game. Looking at the goal scorers as well, if you see, you know, Cairo, he scored 13 odd goals and Yilmaz has got 6. So what do you have to say about the top scorers of the two teams and the way they play, the football they play? Do you think there'll be a lot of goals in the first game looking at these two?
No, so there won't be a lot of goals because both teams are very defensively sound from what we've seen in, you know, the qualifying campaigns. But these two have come into their own recently. Ciro Immobile, you know, in the Serie A, he's averaged around 25 goals every season over the last 5 seasons. Okay, Yilmaz primarily has played in the Turkish league, but this year as a free agent signed for eventual Ligue 1 winners, you know, Lille FC. Okay, he was phenomenal over there.
Yeah.
Okay, he transformed them even for the Turkish national team. Okay, during the qualifying campaign, he's been phenomenal. At the same time, Immobile, you know, in over 45 matches, he scored those 13 goals, but he's been a little underwhelming for the national side.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, but from a goal scoring perspective, he's always a danger. Hopefully, he steps up this year for, you know, Italy.
Yes, and as you said, Italians are known to be, you know, good defending units. And I've read some stats that they have scored most goals on set pieces, or rather than open plays. They believe in that kind of football. So what are your thoughts on their game style?
So the Italians, as I said, always were the defensive kind, right? So they sit back and try to hit on the counter, but their speciality has always been set pieces.
Yeah.
Okay, the free kick delivery is always impeccable, and their centre backs are imposing, okay, to say the least.
Yes.
So when they attack the ball, they usually get their head on it, and more often than not, they hit the target.
But this time it's going to be different, Sid, because there's no Andre Pirlo to take those free kicks, and you know, there's no Totti. There are no Tottis and Luca Tonis who will go and finish up those goals. So it's going to be different, difficult, but it's going to be an interesting challenge as well.
Yeah, Turkey, as I said, they're perpetual dark horses, and they can spring a few surprises as they do in every tournament. So, even this time, I think so.
Okay, definitely.
So, even during the qualifying campaign, okay, if you see, Turkey defeated France once and drew the other. So, they are undefeated against the reigning world champion. So, they have it in them.
Yes, they do. That is true. That is true, Sid.
Yeah.
And, you know, speaking of the, you know, the impact players or the players to watch out for, who do you think and why? Who would be the player to watch out for in both these teams?
Yeah, so I'll give you a few examples. Okay, so as you said, Ciro Immobile is going to be one of the main points of focus for Italy. Okay, they need their striker to fire all guns blazing. Okay, so he's going to be one person to look out for. And obviously, his Serie A record is impeccable, as I mentioned earlier. But on the international stage, it's his time to step up. Okay. The other person is Chiesa, in my opinion, from the Italian national team.
Yes.
He's going to be, you know, one of the main focus points from an attacking point of view. The supplier for Ciro. Okay. So that's the second person from the Italian national team who I think will play a huge role in the Italian team's road to success, you know, if they want to win the championship. And
correct.
The last person from the Italian national team who I think will play a huge role is Nicola Barella. You know, Inter team that's just won the Serie A. He's been their engine, their main focus point. Okay, he links defense to attack. Okay, so he's going to be the main person who probably, you know, big shoes to fill in terms of Pirlo. Okay, even his partner Verratti is currently injured, so he is going to be the one who, you know, runs the show. Locatelli has been drafted in, but let's see how they perform. If you see from the Turkish side, obviously Yilmaz, main you know, striker, in form. Okay, both on the international and league stage. The other person who I think, you know, will play a huge role is Zeki Seric, who's their right back. Okay, again from Lille. He's formed a good understanding and partnership with Yilmaz. So, you know, understand a lot of attacks are going to be coming in from the right. Okay, and finally, the next player who I think will have a huge impact for, you know, Turkey is going to be Hakan Çalhanoğlu. Okay, he is the main attacking point for AC Milan, and he's proved so over the last few years. You know, even that amazing free kick against Borussia Dortmund, okay, a 40-yard strike. So his set piece delivery is also impeccable. So a lot of attacks are going to be focused around these three for Turkey, I believe.
Sid, there's an interesting question that I have for you. You know, what do you think? Because Italians are known, as we always have talked, you know, spoken about their defense and how they are very good at the back. Do you think when it comes to an international level, when they play at a tournament of such magnitude, they kind of tend to change their tactics against different teams? Because obviously, when you're playing a France, you know they are on the attacking side. You need to be well-oiled at the back. But when you're playing a Turkey, although they are dark horses, but they're still a bit vulnerable when it comes to this level. They've not been consistent enough. So do you think the Italians would have a different tactic, you know, in their armory or something like that?
So yes, what they'll do is they'll still not change their defensive, you know, setup. Okay, because as I said, tournaments like these are, you know, neck and neck. One mistake and you're out. You just look at Germany in the last World Cup. Okay, everyone expected them to perform brilliantly with the squad. Plus, they were the reigning champions at the time.
Yeah.
But they tried a little too much too soon. Okay, and you need the team to gel. Okay, you have, you know, pre-tournament matches, friendlies, etc. But there's only so much that a team can gel. You'd still want your core, you know, practice. I won't say it's practice, but, you know, prepare for France while playing for Turkey. Ensure that you're not leaking any goals, but also concentrate on the attack. So maybe one or two attackers will be changed around for this match, you know, make it a little more attacking. But from a defensive side, I think they'll still maintain that core.
That's true. That is true. And now, you know, Sid, I would like to take your opinion. Who do you think is going to come out victorious in this game? Because people have clearly, you know, come out and have spoken about Italians being the winners in this one, being the group toppers in this group as well. But talking about this game, what do you think, who's going to win this one?
Yeah, so it's a tough one to call, okay? I'll give you a few facts and, you know, the last one might be the clincher. Okay, so, you know, one is that Turkey has lost all four of their opening games in Euro finals.
Wow.
Okay, so they've never won their opening match.
Okay,
so that, exactly. So there's a little bit of pressure on them to win this. Okay, but at the same time, Italy were one of the only two teams alongside Belgium who had a 100% win record. Okay, during the qualifying campaign, they won all 10 of their games just like Belgium. So while I'm saying these facts, you know, Belgium is also one of the contenders bases their qualifying stats. Okay,
yeah.
The next thing is that Turkey conceded only 3 goals in the 10 games in the qualifying campaign. And that's the joint best defensive record alongside Belgium again.
Wow, okay.
Okay, and finally, you know, Italy has never lost at the Stadio Olimpico in a major tournament, be it World Cup or Euros. Okay.
I don't know what to say.
Yeah, and again, Italy and Turkey faced off in the opening match in Euro 2000, in which Italy was victorious then 2-1. Okay, Conte, one of everyone will know Conte, right? He was one of the scorers then, and you know, going forward, I think Italy does have the edge, basis history and the stats that we have, but through the qualifying campaign, Turkey has been very stubborn at the back. So it's going to be a little difficult to break them also.
So, who's your winner? You've not answered my question yet.
Yes, I'm trying to avoid that. It's a little tough. Okay, but I think, again, a 2-1 victory for Italy is what I'll go for. Because both of them are going to try and step out and, you know, attack the other. Knowing that the other is defensive, so they'll try and look and pick for chinks in the armor.
Interesting, 2-1 Italy. People would be surprised that Italy have not kept a clean sheet being a defensive unit. So, you're going to get a lot of DMs now. But speaking of today's game, it's going to be an interesting game. Two very good sides. Turkey well deserved to reach to the Euros. They've really worked hard and fought hard. And Italians, as they have a rich history, they are the greatest as it is. And who do you think is going to be the player today? The player who made that change?
For me, again, it's going to be Barella, because he's going to dictate play for the Italians and break up play as well. Okay, so the Turks have to get past him, and at the same time, he's going to be pinging those long balls out wide for the attacks.
Absolutely. So, thanks so much, Sid, for joining with me. 2-1 Italy, absolutely. That's what you've said. I'll see you tomorrow at the same time, and we're going to talk about the thrilling games that are on our hands.
Absolutely. Looking forward to it, man.
Definitely. Have a great day, bro. Take care.
You too, man. Take care.